Hello, very good evening. So we wait for our examiners to come. Yes, Shamim. So we will start at 2 p.m. Thank you. Okay, we can start now. All right, very good evening to all the participants for the FYP1, okay, for the BCE, Bachelor of Computer Engineering, FYP1 final presentation. So today we have two candidates, which are Sumi and Rajiv. Okay, so thanks to our examiners for their coming today and to evaluate this student. So without we waste our time, I would like to call the first candidate, Rajiv Suresh Nair, for his title is Design and Implementation of Multi-Parameter Patient Monitoring System using IoT. So are you ready, Rajiv?
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you very much. All right, for your information, this session will be using the play video by the participant. This video already recorded yesterday, and now I just play the recording, and during the live session, you need to be live, okay? You need the Q&A session, sorry. You need to be live. All right, so I will play the video.
And SOMAC. My name is Rajiv Suresh Nair, and today I will be presenting my FYP1 thesis for the project Design and Implementation of a Remote Multi-Parameter Patient Monitoring System using IoT. To start off, I would like to show an outline for this presentation. First, I will state the need for this project and how it offers a solution in the problem statement. Next, I will list some objectives that this research aims to achieve, followed by the scope of the study, questions that this research answers, a hypothesis, literature that I have reviewed for this research, some preliminary data regarding the budget of this project, and finally, my plans for FYP2 in the next semester. Traditionally, patients are to visit doctors at hospitals or clinics to receive consultation and treatment. This, however, not only puts a financial burden on the patients in the form of transportational and hospitalization fees, but they also risk getting infected with other diseases whilst they are still in these premises. This issue can be resolved by a remote multi-parameter patient monitoring system that allows patients to be discharged early after receiving intensive care to be monitored from the comfort of their own home. This monitoring system will be based on a support vector machine algorithm to tailor the system to a per patient basis to provide a more effective warning system. The objectives for this research are as follows. 1. To design and develop a remote multi-parameter patient monitoring system using a microcontroller, Arduino in this case, and IoT technology. 2. It is to design and develop a notification system that contacts healthcare providers when a patient's condition goes below specific threshold and the support vector machine algorithm classifies their condition as undesirable. Lastly, it is to design and develop a communication interface to allow support for video conferencing between a doctor and their patients, to hold regular health checkups, as well as to view the biotelemetry sent by the sensors of the monitoring system. The scope of the study involves reviewing the concept of patient monitoring systems and their applications, one such of which being remote patient monitoring systems and their current trends. Reviewing these trends, we have arrived at a proposed system, a remote multi-parameter patient monitoring system, and their design, key components, methodology followed for the research for this project, preliminary data pertaining to its budget, as well as plans to construct this project in the next semester in FYP2 are reviewed. Questions. Some questions answered by this research are whether a patient can sufficiently be monitored from a non-traditional recovery setting. In other words, whether patients can be safely and sufficiently monitored from outside a hospital or clinic environment. This has been shown to be true as the literature reviewed for this research. Secondly, can a remote patient monitoring system diagnose patients? This is untrue, as in order to diagnose and provide treatment to patients, a certified medical professional is required to give their opinion, which a monitoring system cannot do. It can only cater for monitoring and providing a communication with real-time monitoring and providing communication between doctors and patients, and also to track their records over time. Lastly, whether the chosen group of sensors can provide enough information to accommodate for most emergencies. This is also true, as the sensors used in this remote multi-parameter patient monitoring system are the same, if not more, than the ones used in traditional patient monitoring systems in hospitals. Next, the hypothesis for this research. A remote multi-parameter patient monitoring system that monitors a wide variety of vital signs for a patient from the comfort of their own home is proposed in this research. This system recognizes the patient's stable or equilibrium state and classifies whether a patient requires attention or not by using a machine learning algorithm called support vector machine algorithm. It also provides an interface built using a Python-based micro framework called Flask to provide interaction between a patient and doctor, to provide support for remote health checkups, as well as to view the vital sign information collected by the sensors. For the literature review for this research, it is shown in the following table. There are 5 papers that have been shown in this table in this presentation. The first paper is titled Arduino Uno and GSM-based wireless health monitoring systems for patients. This is a design project deployed in a hospital, and it uses Arduino as well as GSM modules to send the data from the Arduino to the web server. It monitors parameters such as heartbeat, temperature, and sweat in order to attain stress information. But the limitations for this project are that it does not track records over time, as it only sends an notification when a certain threshold is passed, not saving or archiving records. It also does not allow for any direct communication between a patient and a doctor, or provide tailoring support such as the SVM algorithm in the proposed system. However, this project has found that the system provides notifications to a doctor and eliminates deaths, or at least reduces deaths due to negligence. Effective remote health monitoring systems. This is also a design project, but to deploy it in a home environment using Arduino and Ethernet. This monitors only heartbeat and temperature of a patient, and its limitation are that it monitors even lesser parameters than the previous paper. It does not provide notification services or checkup provisions, and it also does not, the monitoring is also not tailored on a patient-per-patient basis. The third paper review is specifically targeted towards the elderly, titled Intelligent Autonomous Elderly Patient Home Monitoring System. This is also a design project to be deployed in the homes of the elderly, and it uses an IoT gateway and NRF communication to transfer the information to an over the fog layer. The parameters monitored are temperature, glucose, and fall detection using room sensors in the house. The limitations for this are that since it is only monitored or catered towards the elderly, it provides very niche support for the general masses. It also does not provide any checkup provisions or provide any tailored monitoring on a patient per patient group basis. But this project, although uses heat generated from the bodies of the elderly in order to power the sensors, and it has found that it requires much less power to use or deploy this entire system overall. This also provides notification services to the hospitals and alerts authorities when the patients need attention. The fourth paper is a review study titled Remote Patient Monitoring via Non-Invasive Digital Technologies, a systematic review. This study studies patient monitoring systems deployed at home, and it checks specifically targeted towards non-invasive monitoring techniques, which are the type of sensors that I will be using in my project. The limitations, as mentioned in the paper itself, are that the assessment done was not of higher quality. The studies conducted were on a small patient population. The duration of the study was short, as well as the results were over-descriptive and not very informative, as said by the paper itself. Finally, remote patient monitoring system by Sebastian in the year 2012 is a design project deployed at home using Arduino and Android and GSM technologies, which specifically measures heartbeat. This system, however, is the most limited out of all systems, as it does not use its own patient monitoring techniques, as it reads data from a pre-existing patient monitoring system by using OCR to read the value of heartbeat in the display window of the patient monitoring system and send that via GSM over to Android C2DM servers in order to provide track information. Therefore, the limitations for this project, this final paper, are that it provides limited parameters to be monitored. The readings are, as mentioned, not taken directly, but taken using a pre-existing generic patient monitoring system. And it does not provide any checkup provisions or is not tailored towards individual patients. For the preliminary data for this research, the budget of the proposed system has been listed in the following table. Each component in this table has been sourced from Lazada or Shopee, which are e-commerce websites from Malaysia. As you can see, the overall price of this system does not exceed 250 ringgits. This is in stark comparison with standalone systems such as the ones listed in this table, including a sphygmomanometer, which is a blood pressure monitor priced at 200 ringgits, and a pulse oximeter priced at 225 ringgits from reputed companies such as Omron and Medicina. These systems do not provide any recording services, notification services, or otherwise, and only provide a singular function, that is to give a reading for a particular vital sign, in this case, blood pressure and saturation of blood oxygen. They are also priced at almost the same price as the proposed system, and hence the proposed system is extremely low cost while providing much greater functionality than others in the similar price bracket. My plans for FYP2 are to begin with the design of the proposed system and to begin with the assembly of the hardware required for the remote multi-parameter patient monitoring system. I will also begin with programming the software involved in this project, which include the code for the communication interface written in Flask, which is a Python-based microfilm work, as well as to code and train the support vector machine learning algorithm in order to classify between desirable and undesirable values in a data set. Finally, I would like to deliver a final prototype before the deadline at the end of the next semester. This is a Gantt chart that shows how my activities are spread out over the next semester during FIP2. And the activities span a duration of 95 days from the beginning of the semester towards the end, where I will provide a final prototype report and present the same prototype for my FIP2. The activities in this are the same as what I have mentioned earlier, involving the acquisition of hardware and programming of the software and just overall testing of the system. All other research and studies have already been done in FIP1 now. So yeah, to conclude, a patient monitoring system is essential for a safe recovery, as not only does it monitor a patient after being given intensive care, but it also monitors whether the given drugs or medicines have taken the right toll on the patient and it's working as they are supposed to. Remote monitoring systems provide monitoring outside traditional settings such as hospitals and clinics, and the proposed system is such that it aims to fulfill the following tasks, which are to provide a monitoring system that is tailored to each patient to increase its effectiveness, to reduce travel and hospital costs for each patient so they don't have to keep traveling to and from hospitals and their homes and can recover safely and comfortably in their own space. And finally, it also reduces death by negligence, as the system monitors the patient's vital signs in real time, and it offers notification and alarm services to notify authorities when each patient needs attention. Okay. Thank you. Good morning.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Raji. All right, so now I would like to open for the Q&A session.
I have a question. You're going to do this as your FY2 in next session, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The testing part, I think you must have, where are you going to do this, by the way? You're going to do in Malaysia, or you're going to do it in India?
I'm planning to return to Malaysia in March, so I'll continue with that.
Okay. Because I'm sure you can do this. I think you have done a lot of work. I think I'm very confident that you can deliver this product. The only thing is that when about talking about testing the product with the actual patient, have you got any plan to discuss with any medical center or what? That's my question.
Not yet. I plan to get a working model first before trying to show anyone about.
Well, yes, true. You need to have a working model first. But the thing is that, is this worthwhile? Because I think remote monitoring is something that is very looked for by a lot of people nowadays. So if you can come up with a basic prototype using sensors that you have mentioned, you can identify maybe Manipal Medical Center should be able to accommodate you. You should have put inside your plan. All right, so that's my advice to you. Okay, because I think I'm sure you can do that. If you know IoT, you know those microcontrollers, I'm sure you can do that. Because there's so, even I have ex student have been doing this before, but it was unfortunate that he was doing it during the GSM days. But now you can use the iPhone and IoT stuff. The only thing is that there was a report that I've read. The level of communication between your gadget and the control center, that's the issue when talking about medical centers, because sometimes if your design does not take care of your spectrum management, you may interfere with the instrumentation in the hospital, for instance. That could be an issue. So I think you should be reading some material further on the electromagnetic compatibility so that you can eradicate this problem
before you start. It's going to be installed at home. So I don't think that's going to be...
I know. But sometimes when you talk about medical center, sometimes you have to accommodate that as well. Sometimes you can see that even though at home, sometimes some patients, they have got their own monitoring equipment attached to their body. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And you provide an alternative to that, because your staff is going to be very handy, very small, I suppose. But if there is any medical instrument attached to the body of the patient, then the issue of electromagnetic compatibility will come into picture. That's why you must survey what range of frequencies that you're going to use. For instance, if it is IoT, then no problem. Maybe you write on the existing infrastructure. But you're talking about remote area that doesn't have internet infrastructure, you need to use maybe ISM band, which is basically 1.2G, that kind of stuff, you know. But anyway, that's my comment to you. I'm sure you can do it, no problem, all right?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Consider that. Thank you.
Hey, Mr. Shami, you have any question?
Yeah. So, Rajiv, good work done. Can you share, open the grand chat slide? And Dr. Ahmed, can you move that slide?
Okay, I think, Rajiv, can you share your screen, please?
Yes, sir. One sec.
The FIP2 plan or timeline that you can share.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So you have already done the FIP1, so almost completed, and that is very good. What is the final output of FIP1? Learning and a paper, something else?
I've done all the necessary studies and research, so I can go into FIP2 by just starting to do the project directly.
Okay, and are you putting up this in a paper format or just going into the FIP2 only?
I'm sorry, sir?
Are you putting this entire study into a research paper format or only going for FIP2?
Yes, I have done a review paper on this.
Okay. Have you submitted somewhere?
Yes, sir. Given it to sir.
Okay, fine. So in the FIP2, can you tell what is the current status of your learning in the FIP2? So what is your plan? What have you learned that you will be using in FIP2?
I learned what applications, what platforms I'll be using, and
Can you tell that what exactly you'll be using?
I'll be using, for the communication interface, I'll be using Flask, which is a web micro framework based on Python.
Okay, have you learned that or you will be starting that learning right now?
I'll be learning that after my exams now.
Okay, what else?
I'll be using a web platform called Heroku, where I'll upload these files, the support vector machine algorithm and the Flask application.
Okay. The Heroku, have you started learning or you will do after exams?
I just have to create an account on it and upload my files there, which will receive data from the sensors as well.
Okay, next what?
That's about it. I have already bought a few components for the project myself here, the Wi-Fi module, and I'm just waiting on an Arduino, and then the sensors I'll have to buy in Malaysia because they're very expensive here.
Okay.
That's
okay. So with respect to software and hardware, partially it is done, partially is pending. So do you think in the 3 months time that you have learning a new platform, you said a Flask or something, so your learning and implementing would be sufficient for you?
Yes, sir. It's based on Python, which I already kind of have experience with. So
okay. Okay, fine. And for the SVM, you will be using simple SVM or some particular type of SVM?
I'll just be using it basically for, since it's good for classifying small data sets, since it'll only be classifying based on the data coming from the sensors, I'll just use it to classify between like a desirable and undesirable state.
So I believe you have
linear classification. Yes.
Okay. So I believe you have an idea about SVM studied in the previous semesters, or you will be learning all again?
No, I researched it during this FIB one.
No, I'm saying the practical point of view. So do you know how to implement SVM into the coding plot?
I haven't done it myself, but I have an idea of how I can do it. I've watched like a few videos. I haven't done it myself though.
No, I'm not saying about your exact example or project. I'm saying any implementation of SVM for any problem, any example, have you tried before or not yet?
No, I haven't tried it.
Okay, fine. Okay, and you also say something about testing part. So what is your idea about testing?
I meant testing. First, I'll be testing if whether my data is being read at the web server. And then next, I'll see if the web server can classify the data as desirable or undesirable based on the support vector machine algorithm and whether it sends notifications. So I'll just be testing at each stage after I'm done with a part.
Okay, so it is not exactly testing in the technical way, you're just observing and monitoring things, is it that? If you go for testing, there are particular levels, categories and types, so are you following something of that sort or just observing the data transfer and flow of work?
I'll just be testing for the system to make sure it's working accordingly and how I want it to.
Okay. If you go into the software engineering or software development lifecycle, in that there is a testing phase. Because I see in your plan there are two times you are using testing keyword, so that I felt you are going for testing exclusively with some specific variations. It seems it is not. If it is not, fine. If it is there, you have to be careful what you are doing exactly. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So your work is good and your plan is also good. Make sure that you're able to complete in a given time. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Fine, that's all from my side.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Shamim. And also thank you for Raji for your presentation. All right, so I think we can move to...
Sir, I have one question for Raju. Can I ask?
Yeah, yes, can. Please.
Yes, sir.
Raju, right, in your hypothesis, right, are you going to test all those hypotheses?
My hypothesis is presenting
right,
the
idea. You define three different hypotheses, right? If you want to prove, for each hypothesis, you need to define an alternative hypothesis, and then you need to design one survey, and you need to collect information. Then you need to perform a t-test, most because you need to perform t-test, and then by using the t-test, you need to prove that statistically, the people are willing to use the remote monitoring system, and then right, you need to prove that right, what are the parameters that are sufficient to monitor to decide type of disease, because the different diseases will need a different type of symptoms to be observed and different parameters need to be considered. So here, right, we are not talking about a particular disease, right? You are talking about right, patient health monitoring means you need to talk about right, different vital signs, something like BP, right, heart, these and all those things. And I don't understand how you can decide that these are the parameters which are sufficient if you don't know about what disease you are diagnosing.
So it's not particularly aimed towards any singular disease, like you said, but it'll give at least an overall idea of the patient's condition, whether they need attention or not. It can't diagnose them or provide any relief. All okay. It does is monitor the patient and notify the authorities if they need to send an ambulance, for example. So that can
now
be measured.
There comes two different questions then. One is that, as you mentioned, right, what is the set of parameters that you want to consider? And before you decide that set, right, how you come about that particular set, right? How you can decide, right, yeah, this is the sufficient minimum amount of set that I need. Okay, that is one thing. And second one is, you need to collect some statistical data, right? What should be the different parameters, something like threshold value. If it crosses, then it is an alarming situation, right? You understand?
Yes, sir.
So that's you need to find out. And coming to the right, remaining two hypothesis, I'm not sure, right, something like whether people like the remote patient monitoring system, okay, and the second hypothesis, I couldn't remember exactly, but I don't, yeah, you can conduct that survey, but it requires, right, a different a survey altogether, and it needs to perform a different statistical test. I don't think it is necessary. Because we need to design a development project, right? We are not bothering about, right, how the patients are willing to use it, right? Hope you understand, right? Because if you look at if you look at your hypothesis, right, you need to prove each hypothesis.
Yes.
What I'm saying is whether you need to prove whether you are going to take the alternative hypothesis or null hypothesis, and you need to, for each hypothesis, you need to define null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis, and statistically you need to prove which one, right, you say that, right, patients would like, right, a remote health monitoring system, right, statistically you need to prove otherwise.
Okay, sir.
If you cannot prove, then you can go with that, I am designing a system that is, that will be used by the patients, because at the end of the day, right, it must be used by the patients, right? So you are proving, right, statistically, right, your experiment, your whatever the system that you are designing, that will be used by the patients. For that, you need to conduct one study. Now, my question is, right, do we really need to conduct such a survey, something like marketing survey, that what we call as a market survey, that we need to do? Otherwise, we assume that, right, whatever the system that we are building, that system will be used by the patient, so that directly you can create your product. Something like you can design your remote health monitoring system by using support vector machines. And it is the support vector machines can be used as a classifier and as well as a regression, right? How you want to design? Is it a support vector machine classifier or a support vector?
It's a classifier.
Classifier. You need to mention that clearly.
Yes.
Okay. How you get that data for training the SVM? How we are planning to get the data to train the SVM? At the end of the day, SVM is nothing but it is something, a classifier, right? It is just a linear separator, nothing more than that. You are drawing a boundary line. So how you are planning to get the data for that one?
I'd feed it general dummy data from a patient's vital signs, basically all the parameters.
So
that
here you are defining two different classes, sir. Multi-class support vector machine or two binary support vector machine?
It's binary. It's either it's desirable or undesirable.
Based upon the symptoms, right? Whether it is an alarm situation or it is a normal, that's the differentiation you are making here.
Yes, sir.
So if what is the boundary here? What are the support vector classifiers? Something like, if this particular parameter is, right, more than this, right, likewise, you need to have a real data. Based on that real data, you define these whiskers or otherwise support vector machines, what we call. Okay, so you need, right, real-time data.
I haven't really thought that far into training it yet, but I thought I'll first provide a general boundary based on, like, for example, it's a known fact that temperature can't exceed a certain point, otherwise it's fatal.
Essentially what you are doing is, right, you are building what you call that one as a finite state machine with if then logic. It's not anything based on ML. It is just, right, you are designing a something like a sequential logic using if then rules. If the temperature is greater than that, and, right, you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir, but it's not just temperature. I was given an example, but like for some people, they have a lower
blood
pressure
than usual. If X is greater than that one and if X and Y greater than this much, right, it boils down to nested ifs.
Yes, sir, but like for example, if someone has like a lower blood pressure than usual, which is their stable state, for example, like the monitoring system should adapt to that to accommodate for it. So like it doesn't give false positives. If I put a rule-based one, it'll generalize it for everyone.
Okay, then if you want to build, right, a machine learning system for this, right, you need to have the data and you need to train the model by using the data. So you give input and output, the logic, the algorithm will come up with its own logic, okay?
Okay, so I'll look into it.
Yeah, just think about, right, how you gather the data for that. It's one concern, that's it.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Satya. Okay, so I think that's all for this presentation. So now we move to Sumit's presentation. So are you ready, Sumit?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Welcome, examiners. My name is Swami Bhattacharji, and today I'm going to present on my FIP 1 final report. My topic for the FIP is multi-channel QCM for oral characterization of volatile organic compounds, and it is supervised by Dr. Ahmad Anwar Zainati. So in this presentation, I'm going to talk about several subtopics. And I'm going to explain firstly on the problem statement, my intent for this project. Next, I'm going to explain the objectives behind this research project, the scope of the study, some research questions in order to understand the objectives, the hypothesis which is used for this project. Next, I'm going to speak about some of the recent publications related to this project and the future plan for my FIP2. And lastly, I'm going to discuss the overall summary, and then I'm going to conclude my presentation. So in order to understand the intent of my project, we need to know the problems behind it and what are the reasons for my project. So firstly, VOCs are volatile organic compounds. These are hydrocarbons, usually existing in the vapor state, and these are emitted from industries and households, which contribute to major environmental and also health issues. For these, for the detection of these compounds, there has been many devices developed, such as gas chromatography and resonance, magnetic resonance resolution devices. But researchers recently prefer piezoelectric crystal sensors over the traditional mechanisms for the VOC detection. So conventional QCM only provides a single electrode channel to detect the VOCs, which is not quite optimal for our project because it has low sensor surface area for detection, and also it lowers down the scope of how many VOCs we can detect at a time. And these piezoelectric crystal sensors can behave differently in different environments. The sensitivity highly depends on what kind of medium it is in, whether it is air or liquid. There is an overwhelming abundance of sensing materials used for these QCM sensors, so we need to identify the perfect electrode sensing material used for the project. So the objectives for this research are to design and simulate a multi-channel QCM using the COMSOL multiphysics software. It's a simulating software where we can simulate the design of the QCM sensor and hence find the results. Our next objective is to compare and investigate three kinds of sensors. So in this project, I'm going to focus on developing three sensors, one dual sensor QCM, one triple sensor QCM, and one quad sensor QCM. And all of these are for the purpose of odor characterization of VOCs. My next objective is to develop a novel theoretical model for a QCM that is used to gather VOC profiles and to identify selectively what kind of VOC we are going to identify. Lastly, I have to study the surface chemistry of the electrode so that I can choose the optimal sensing material for the gas analytes. The scope of this FIP1 study is to find out information about the C2C distance, which is the interchannel distance, the distance kept between two sensors in a MQCM, and to design the QCMs with optimal frequency and thickness of the crystal, because the thickness of the crystal highly influences the sensitivity of the device. Also, I need to focus on how to choose the right sensing material for each sensor so as to capture and detect the VOCs at its highest sensitivity value. To list out the VOC range of gases we are going to identify, and also to finally visualize the vapors identified by the device. So in order to solve our problem statement and also to achieve our objectives, we need to ask some questions, some research questions, which are the following. What are the optimum design parameters for designing an MQCM? What is the material for the electrode to be used for the highest possible mass sensitivity value? What are the possible challenges and limitations that can be observed during the simulation? What are the factors involved during the odor identification? And also, if we can characterize and identify each VOC correctly and with high sensitivity value. This entire QCM system, the device, is based on a single hypothesis, and which is also based on the principle of Sorbery's theorem. So it explains about the relation between the mass sensitivity and the resonant frequency of a quartz crystal microbalance. The image on the right identifies the crystal behavior when an AC current is passed through the electrode and an acoustic wave is generated. This acoustic wave has a change in its resonance frequency, and hence with the help of that change in the resonant frequency, we can calculate the mass sensitivity. Also, as I stated before, the thickness of the quartz crystal influences the sensitivity of the device, and it is inversely proportional to the change in the resonant frequency. And each sensor is also kept at a specific distance from each other in the same device. To explain the entire FIP, I have listed out some of the recent publications on a related topic, which is the multi-electrode QCM sensor for VOC detection. And today I have selected five of those papers to discuss about what are the parameters that we need to find out and what is the main theory behind this QCM sensing. First of all, we have, and all this literature review is categorized depending on the sensing material which is used. So there are four sensing materials today, and for those four sensing materials, I'm going to present five of the papers. First of all, we have oxides and oxide composite. In the first paper, the sensing material used is graphene oxide. Now, graphene oxide is an oxide component, and it is heavily used in gas sensing recently. In this specific paper, the frequency of the QCM sensor is chosen as 9 megahertz, and the thickness is chosen 168 micrometers. The diameter of the electrode is 5 millimeter, and in total, there are two sensors which are fabricated on the same wafer of crystal. The sensitivity obtained from this sensor is 22.9 hertz per parts per million, and the response and recovery time are 60 seconds and 200 seconds. To explain the response time, it identifies the amount of time when the crystal shows a change in the resonant frequency, a drop in the resonant frequency, and the recovery time identifies that the amount of time when the resonant frequency goes back to its original value. The second type of sensing material used here is the modified polymeric materials. So modified polymeric materials are basically polymer coatings and thin films. Here in this paper, they have used different kinds of polymer thin films such as PAN, PVC, and PPP. And the VOCs detected with this sensing material are methanol, ethanol, propanol, butanol, benzene, toluene, and xylene. There are four sensors fabricated on this device, and the frequency of the crystal is 10 megahertz, and the thickness is 168 micrometers. The sensitivity values obtained are quite high, but the highest observed is in PVC, The next polymeric material is polypeptide solution coating. So polypeptide solution coating is a mix, is a blend of polymer and amino acids, and it is used in this device, which has 6 sensors in total, and the same kind of frequency, which is 10 megahertz and 168 micrometers of thickness. Here they have detected acetic acid, butyric acid, ammonia, dimethylamine, benzene, and chlorobenzene. And the sensitivity obtained is 0.35 hertz milligram per liter, which is also considered quite average, the sensitivity value. Our next category is MIP. MIP is also known as molecularly imprinted polymers. MIPs are used in case polymers are unable to obtain high sensitivity values because of its low surface area. So in MIP, it can capture the gas analytes more correctly and with high sensitivity values. In this paper, they have used PAA MIP coating, which has 3 sensors. In this device, they have 3 sensors in total. And the VOCs detected are propionic acid, hexanoic acid, and octanoic acid. There are 3 sensors here, and 3 of the sensors act individually as a separate sensor, and hence they have separate sensitivity values. It is seen that sensor 2 has the highest resonant frequency, thus it has the highest sensitivity, and the resonant frequency of the sensor 2 is about 70 hertz. Lastly, we have the last category of the sensing material, which is nanostructures. Nanostructures are a recent, recently they are popular in gas sensing to detect VOCs in very complex environments. Here in this paper, they have used ZNO nanorods coated with polymer. And they have grown the ZNO nanorods on 3 sensors in total. And each of these sensors have different diameters, which are 4 millimeter, 5 millimeter, and 6 millimeter. And the VOCs detected by this device is ethanol or toluene impurities. Impurities specifically in gasoline. And the sensitivity value is obtained as 6.27 with an error of 0.05 times 10 to the power minus 13. After we understand from the previous papers, we can estimate how much time or what will be the schedule for our FIP2 to implement what we have learned in FIP1. And this is the Gantt chart for my FIP2 as I have planned. Since the semester will be starting in 22nd March, my FIP2 will also start. And estimately, it can be finished before 30th of June 2021. And we have in total 2 drafts and 2 prototypes for the whole simulation and 1 final report. For preliminary data, we can see some of the examples as I've given in this image. This is how usual MQCM looks like when we are simulating it with and each of the sensors are separated from each other by a distance of D, which is the C2C distance, and this is the side view of the sensor. It is expected to get a similar value, a similar kind of graph as shown in this right side image, and this is the VOC detection visualization that we are expecting to get from the FIP2. As I explained before, the software used for the simulation is COMSOL multiphysics software, and it is used to design and simulate the sensor. This image shows the design of a gas sensor, not particularly what my sensor would look like, but this is the overall interface of the software. It is also used after designing and simulating the sensor, it is also used to visualize the sensor data and to obtain the graph of the sensitivity values. To conclude, what we have learned from FIP1 will be implemented in FIP2. And if the desired results are obtained, then I shall create a novel study on MQCM, and three sensors shall be simulated, one with two sensors, one with three sensors, and another one with four sensors. Thank you very much. Good afternoon.
Okay, thank you very much, Sumik, for your presentation. All right, now I would like to open for the Q&A session. Yes, any question? Mr. Said?
I have a just now, Mr. Sumit mentioned about he's going to test about three sensors altogether.
Yes, sir. I'm going to design and simulate three sensors in total.
Three sensors altogether. So all meant for the detection of gas.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is your limit of your research, right? You don't go beyond that. Okay. You're going to use what? Nano tubes, or you're going to use quartz crystal?
The base of the sensor is quartz crystal because it's a QCM, and the sensing material on top of the electrode should be chosen according to the gases I will be detecting. So if I choose benzene, then I would go for polymeric materials, or if I choose other kind of hydrocarbons, then it depends on that.
Okay, very good. Okay, what is the scale of your research in terms of nanometer?
So you mean 14? The total area? Yeah.
Which level? Are you talking about 10 nanometer technology, or are you going to talk about 14, 20?
Oh, okay. So I think it is 45.
45.
I'm not sure about the technology used here because it's not fabricating. So this simulation will be already providing me like the materials.
Yeah, I understand. Understand. You're not fabricating. I asked question before in your previous presentation. But the thing is that when you want to design, you are doing simulation work. I understand. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, simulation work will open up to the actual design one day. It may not be now, maybe during your day doing your master or doing your PhD.
Yes.
I think you better monitor the progress of the material in terms of size. Mm-hmm. What is the current technology that they catch up today? Okay. You need to make sure that your testing environment should be along that line. Because what worries me is that you're going to present one paper one day on this one, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So make sure that you present the paper with the current stand of the
previous kind of.
That's the issue, okay?
Sure.
I don't want people laugh at you because you present 45 nanometer, you know?
Yeah, kind of thing, I get it.
Okay, so very good research. I can see the potential that you are getting into. Because I've been following this before. It seems that some graduate from India, they earn scholarship in the Singapore University, and then they get grant for doing this kind of research.
That would be great.
Yeah, hopefully you can get grant somewhere else, okay? Worldwide. Yeah. It can be from Manipal, but it can be your opportunity is worldwide, all right?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Said. Mr. Shami?
That is a good work. Can you share the objective screen?
Sure, sir. I'll just share.
Okay, fine. So your work is good. I just want your comment on what is the current status on all the four objectives. These four objectives are for FIP1 and FIP2 together.
Yeah.
So at the end of FIP1, what is completed or how much portion is completed in each one of these?
So for the first objective, COMSOL software, I have downloaded it and followed some tutorials so that I can know the basic use of it and the tools which are there. For the second one...
So for the first one, you are ready with the knowledge, you can start implementing.
Not quite ready with how to design a gas sensor, but ready with the interface.
Okay, next.
The next one is it's to investigate and perform the whole simulation. So I have to design it. So that's the learning part that I have to finish, how to use the tools in order to design the gas sensor. And the third part I have done because it's a theoretical model. So I have learned the theory behind the QCM sensors, and I know what kind of sensing material to use in what kind of VOC gas. For the fourth one as well, it's similar because we are focusing on the sensing material. So you could say that I have learned it through my review.
Fine. In the third objective, what is the meaning of novel theoretical model and how can you justify that?
So since here I am designing three sensors in total, and I am comparing each of the sensors with each other depending on the sensitivity. So in the review in the papers that I've reviewed before, it has not been done with multi-channel QCMs before. Everyone has done it with single electrode, and there is very less research work done on multi-channel QCM, and that too comparing with dual, triple, and quad sensors. So you could say if I simulate this, and later on if I can fabricate this anytime, then it would be a novel model.
Okay. In the same one, what is the idea or meaning of complex environment?
Complex environment, such as so let me give an example. VOCs are organic compounds, so these can be found in rotten food and in garbage. So for example, there's a dumpster or a garbage somewhere, and the device needs to sense only for example only benzene.
Okay, that I got, but once you have done it FIP1, you are aiming for FIP2. How can you justify the complexity level, because every order will be complex by nature? So what is the complexity level that you are trying to measure or quantify?
So for my, because there's a limitation in my project because it's a simulation. So what I will do to explain the complex environment is that I will introduce many types of gases at one simulation. So that will explain that the environment is composed of many kinds of gases and not only one. So then the device will have the device, we can test it out that if it can selectively up each gas. Okay. That will be the complex part.
And so I don't exactly recall in your report it is there or not, but if you are trying to have the complex nature, you can mention what is the level of complexity and how can you justify this is this level of complexity.
Okay.
There should be some measurement criteria. I don't know exactly level 1, level 2, 50%, 40%, whatever it is.
Okay.
Can you go to the future schedule, the FIP2 schedule?
It's a video answer. Yeah.
Okay. So in that, what is the idea behind the prototype 1 and prototype 2 as a difference?
So prototype 1 is when I first simulate it with the all the requirements like sensing material and the distance between each sensor. So that will be the first prototype with maybe not so complex environment. In that sense, I mean not so many gases. So it will be the preliminary data that I will collect from the prototype 1. Prototype 2, I will increase the complexity, and then I have to match with the prototype 1 results and see if it's going on a similar trend, and then I'll create the draft on that, and then if I am convinced with both of them, then I'll create the final one.
Okay, if I get the understanding clear, then it is you are doing two simulations with some parameter in one and some other parameter in the second.
Yeah.
Why you are calling it not simulation one, simulation two, or compilation one, compilation two, and calling it prototype one, prototype two? What is the reason of this name?
Sir, because with the word prototype, we mean that if we consider the prototype model of software development, then we can say that we are building prototype two on prototype one. Incremental in the sense. So I thought prototype would be a good term.
Okay, fine. Prototype is a technical word, so you have to be clear with the idea. What you are saying as incremental, that would be good, because prototype is used where the existing version can be used, but you want to improvise that.
Yes.
So if it is a simulation, it may not be actually useful. You can improvise, but it is not currently useful. Prototype means even if you're improvising, the current one is still useful. So in that sense, if you are thinking that way, then it is good. Otherwise, you can try to recheck the word that you have used.
No, sir, I shall recheck the word.
Okay, fine. And what is your idea for the testing part? Is it part of your plan or not?
So sir, since it's a simulation, the whole process is testing, you could say. Because with every simulation, I am testing the complexity of the device. But I have not listed it out in my tasks yet, because I'm not sure of the I'm not sure what's to come in the simulation, since I have not have a hands over on it. But I think my supervisor will help on that.
Okay, fine. So what you told is quite okay, that the entire project is kind of simulation. You are trying and learning and improvising, but that is not mentioned anywhere in the report, that as a project you expect some kind of testing also. And your idea might be clear that I am continuously testing, but that is not put in any written format. So try to highlight that. You may modify that later if you can conduct any exclusive testing, but as of now your plan is it is a regular testing going on.
Yeah.
That is not mentioned. I believe not mentioned anywhere in the report. So try to keep that in mind.
Okay.
I think that's all. Good work. Keep it up.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Shamim and Mr. Subi. All right. Mr. Satya, you have any question?
No, sir. Especially right. What I understand is that he is designing a multi-sensor. That means in your device you are having multiple sensors. Right. Each sensor is try to detect a particular type of gas. Am I understood correctly?
Yes, sir. Correct.
Then, right. Okay. Then you need to talk about something like a reliability issue, and then do you need any maintenance? So you need to say a point that instead of having individual sensors, having one sensor that can detect different types of gases, more reliable. You need to prove that, something like that on that ground. And if you look at your hypothesis, those hypotheses are not looking like any hypothesis. They are looking like a theorem or a statement. Okay, please, if possible, go back and visit your hypothesis and restate them in a proper manner. They are not looking like an hypothesis, to be honest with you. One is the theorem that you cannot prove by a study, you need to prove that by an experiment. The second one is I'm talking about the second one. For one and two, I couldn't remember those hypotheses. If you can go back, they are just statements, it is not something like a lemma, it doesn't look anything like that. Okay,
yeah,
I don't know whether you okay. Something like that, right? I don't have really anything here because I don't know this subject. It's just like Greek and Latin to me. Yeah.
Right. Okay, thank you, Mr. Satya, for your question. And I would like to remind all of my students, okay? All right, so based on what the examiners evaluate your thesis, okay, your project, your presentation, so please keep in mind. Okay, please try to, I will record this session, and please try to get what is the point of the question given by the examiner. And from this question, we try to improve our work, okay? Try to improve our writing, especially in your report, and also for your SIP too. And I think we can start our work after the examination, starting from end of this February, I think. So I will, don't worry, because all of the work will be given by me. Okay, I will try to instruct each of your work how to get the good result later on. Okay, so I think that's all for today. That's all for our presentation, and thank you for your coming for the session, and goodbye. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. All the best.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you very much. Bye.